And I'll tell you, God will never take anybody to heaven who would not rather die than sin. Now, you mark that down. We're going to be talking more about that as we move along in our studies. God will take nobody to heaven who would not choose to die before he would be disloyal and disobedient to God.
Today, Amazing Facts speaker Joe Cruz answers the question, can God trust man with immortality? How can God know that immortalized man will not choose to sin again? Stay tuned for the crusade subject, Satan's Confusing Counterfeits.
Suppose you had to summarize the entire Bible in just two words. I wonder what you'd choose. I've thought about this, friends, and I believe those two words would have to be sin and salvation. Because really, that's what the entire Bible is all about, from Genesis to Revelation. Isn't that right? In the book of Genesis, the old devil came in, you know, to make man sin and to steal away his salvation. And by the way, that was the turning point of the human family. You see, God had based everything on obedience. He had given man all those wonderful gifts, life, righteous character, dominion over the earth, beautiful home in the Garden of Eden. And he said, all of this can be yours on one condition only, and that is you obey. Obey and live, disobey and die. Well, we know, of course, what man did. And sin came down to this earth. It transferred from heaven down to this planet. And man lost all of those wonderful things that he had gained. And you know, from that point, as soon as sin and transgression came into the human family, it was a story of conflict. In other words, it was a mighty controversy going on between God and Satan, truth and error, obedience and disobedience. And the whole Bible from that point on is filled with this great controversy. And it's also filled with God's great plan and program to bring man back to that original position of obedience from which he fell. In fact, every book of the Bible, every chapter and verse and line practically is occupied with that tremendous program of God and heaven to restore man back to that original position. Thou shalt call his name Jesus, the Bible says, for he shall save his people from their sin. Now, sin, of course, is disobedience, isn't it? It's breaking the law. Now, I've had people say to me, well, you know, Brother Joe, that old business of works and keeping the law and obeying the commandments, that's only external fleshly things. Those are the outward works, and God is not interested in those things. He's only interested in the heart. Well, now, friends, let me tell you something. Back in the beginning, that was the big issue, wasn't it? Obedience. You see, that's always been God's test of love and God's test of loyalty. Is our willingness to serve him and obey him. And in the beginning, God said, this is it. If you want to really show your love for me, if you want to show that you're loyal to me, keep my commandments. Obey me. I'm giving you this word and this commandment. And so it has always been, friends. We come down to the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation. And you know, once again, we find that the great test God has made is the same, a test of love, a test of loyalty. In fact, the outstanding characteristic of those in the book of Revelation who will be saved out of this earth and translated from this earth are those that keep the commandments of God. You see, the conditions that God set up in the beginning for man to remain in the Garden of Eden became the conditions in the book of Revelation for man to return to the Garden of Eden, the very same. In fact, you just go through that last book of the Bible and you'll find it so. Revelation 14:12. Here's the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Revelation 12:17. The dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Revelation 22:14. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. So, friends, God must have a people that he can trust with immortality and with eternal life. I mean, God is not going to take away our power of choice when he takes us to heaven, is he? When we receive immortality, are we also going to be deprived of the power of choosing and making our own decisions? Why, of course not. And throughout all eternity, it will still be left up to those redeemed people to make their own choices and their own decisions. Now, you might say, well, Brother Joe, you know, that's a dangerous thing for God to take people to heaven. who might choose to disobey him again. Suppose sin comes into this world again and we have to go through another long 6,000-year siege of this suffering and pain and death. Well, now, friends, that will never happen. We know that. The Bible says that affliction will not rise the second time, so there won't be any more choices by people to disobey God. Well, you say, how can God know that? How can he trust us with eternal life? And what about the angels? You know, how are they going to know that we'll not subject the universe to the same long siege of death as we have before by transgression? Well, now, friends, God will know because of what we are now. And what we're doing now, you see, this is the testing place. This is where we prove to God, my friends, that we can be loyal to him, that we can choose to obey him under any circumstances whatsoever. And I'll tell you, God will never take anybody to heaven who would not rather die than sin. Now, you mark that down. We're going to be talking more about that as we move along in our studies. God will take nobody to heaven who would not choose to die before he would be disloyal and disobedient to God. Now, friends, the program of Satan has always been to make man disobey, to make man sin. See, Satan knows that sin will never go to heaven. No sin will go through the gates of the city. Revelation 21:27 says, nothing that defileth will go through the gates of that city. And sin is the only thing defiles as far as God is concerned. And as I mentioned the other day, you know, the devil knew and understood a principle long before the Apostle Paul ever wrote it down in his epistle. Let's turn to Romans 6 now for our first text. In Romans 6, verse 16, here is a tremendous principle that Satan knew and understood long ago, even before the foundations of the world were laid. Know ye not, Paul writes, that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Now, Paul says in this verse that whoever we obey, we become the servant of that power. So if we obey God, we're a servant of God. If we obey sin, we're a servant of sin. If we obey Satan, we're a servant of Satan. And so you see, friends, how very important this business of obedience is. And the devil knows this. Now, if he can make you sin and keep on sinning, he can keep you out of heaven. That will be an effective way to keep you from ever going to heaven. So what do you think Satan is going to do? He's going to focus his attack against the people of this earth to make them sin and break God's law and thereby demonstrate disloyalty to him. So Satan in every generation has been creating conditions to make men sin. He has been devising strategies and tricks to make people disobey God. And he's gone about it in various ways. And you know what he's done? In the book of Revelation, we find that he's distilled this whole program of attacking God's people and causing them to sin. He has distilled it down into one mighty issue of disobedience. And it's the issue, as we've discovered, of the mark of the beast and the seal of God. In other words, it's going to concern the law of God. It's going to concern keeping his commandments. And so there in the book of Revelation, we have the whole story outlined. We have the two sides represented in the great controversy. Those who follow God and keep his commandments and obey all of his commandments, whether it's easy, whether it's convenient or not. And then those who will choose to follow some pagan counterfeits and some pagan substitutes rather than to obey God at some disadvantage to themselves. And so that is the issue we find. Now, friends, the devil doesn't care why you disobey as long as you do it. Have you ever thought of that? I mean, you can think of the most religious reason that you want to for disobeying God. And that will make Satan very happy indeed. And I can tell you right now, according to what I've studied in the Bible and in history, I have found, friends, that some of the most religious people have been the most disobedient people. Now, notice I said religious, not spiritual. And this has always been true. Religious people being disobedient to God. You say, Brother Joe, I don't understand how that could be. Why would religious people be disobedient to God? Well, friends, Jesus said himself, in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Now, he talked about people who were worshiping him. He was talking about people in churches. And he said, they're disobeying me. And they're worshiping me in vain because instead of keeping my commandments, they're bringing in the traditions of men and the commandments of men. Now, here's another good question I want to ask today. Who is it that is committing the most open and flagrant disobedience to God's holy law today? Who is it that's doing the most wicked things in the world? All right, now there are certain laws of God in the Ten Commandments that are being broken today only by non-religious people, non-church people. For example, stealing, committing adultery, killing. You know, church people don't do those things. Oh, no. That's only the non-religious people that will do that. But I want to remind you, my friends, that there's at least one commandment among those 10 that religious people and non-religious people alike are transgressing. In fact, I suppose that it's a one commandment that is being broken more than any other commandment among the 10. And like I say, the devil is rejoicing greatly because he's not only been able to deceive the non-religious people to make them break that law, but he's also got the religious world so that they're breaking it also. Now, the fourth commandment says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work. But my friends, millions of Christian people today are ignoring that commandment. They're not keeping the seventh day at all. They're keeping another day of their choice rather than the one that God chose and commanded for them to keep. Now, this is a mystery. It is a mystery to me. It's a mystery to many people. But every time I think of this, my thoughts go back to that word of Jesus when he said, in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. He is saying there that people are going to be worshiping me. They'll be doing it in my name, but he said they'll be breaking my law and keeping the traditions, commandments of men instead of keeping my law. Isn't that strange, friends? Now today, we're going to talk about Satan's two main strategies in getting people to sin, in getting people to break his law. Now remember, he wants to present a program that'll cause non-religious people to sin, and he's got to come along with a program that will also make religious people sin, because everybody is the target of Satan. And to downgrade the law of God and to bring the law of God into disrepute and cause people to break the law of God, that's the program of Satan. So what is he going to do now? Two particular favorite strategies that he uses in getting people to sin or break the law of God. That's what we want to talk about right now. But remember this now, Satan is a great counterfeiter, isn't he? He's a deceiver and a liar from the very beginning, but a master counterfeiter. And he doesn't care, my friends, if you know the Bible even. You can quote the scriptures as long as you'll disobey in one point. In fact, he doesn't care if you keep 90% of God's law. You can even keep 98, 99% of it, and the devil will rejoice over that as long as you will put in something there that you will disobey God in. Because as we read a moment ago in Romans 6:16, it's to whom you give your obedience that you become the servant of that power. And if you disobey God willfully and deliberately in any one point, you are not a servant of God. We just read it. And so Satan then tries to get people to break at least one of those laws and to do it willfully and deliberately. And if he can't get you to really study the Bible and know the Bible and understand the requirements of God, he'll twist the word around and distort the word and misapply the word so that you're still wrong in your obedience to him. You know, the devil can quote the Bible very well, can't he? He quoted it to Jesus, you remember, out in the desert there. And he said, go ahead and jump off, cast yourself down. The Bible says that angels are waiting down there to catch you up in their arms, lest you dash your foot against a stone. Go ahead and jump. You see, a presumptuous misapplication of the Bible, and he'll do that to you and he'll do it to me, if he possibly can. And so, like I say, he will mix up a lot of truth even in his own program, in his own teaching, to disarm you, see? And then he'll mix in very cleverly a little bit of his own leaven of disobedience and sin. And he'll be very happy for you to go down the road keeping 98% of the law of God and yet doing 2% of his service, because he knows that will still keep you from going into the kingdom of heaven. So now let's come to these two things that Satan uses in attacking the law of God and in causing people to sin. Here's his first argument. He says, all right, the Bible says that only those who keep the commandments of God are going through the gates of the city into heaven. So this must mean then that works are the most important thing of all. And that if we can just make ourselves obey the law of God and keep those commandments perfectly, being very, very careful not to deviate in one little thing, if we can work hard enough and be good enough and keep the law well enough, why, we can go to heaven. We'll get through the gates of the city. So concentrate on that. Focus on those works. Now, friends, let me ask you something. Is there some truth in that? Yes, it is important to keep the commandments of God, isn't it? We just read that in the book of Revelation. But what else is in that argument of Satan, my friends? The deadly leaven of legalism, isn't that right? You can't work yourself to heaven. You can't save yourself by being good. You can't keep the commandments well enough to actually merit salvation and to be able to go through the gates of the city. Of course not. But Satan makes us believe that we can do it. And that we ought to do it. And if we just try hard enough and apply ourselves well enough to the works of the law and the keeping of the commandments, that we can make it. We can qualify. And we'll be a part of God's people in the kingdom of heaven. Now, friends, multitudes of people have fallen for that. You know that? There are millions of people today who go under the name of Christian, who operate in the name of Christ, who are a legalist, and they're trying to work their way to heaven. They believe that somehow they will be able to just earn their salvation by keeping the law, by being good enough to do that. Now, you may say, Brother Joe, I don't understand why that would make anybody break the law of God. The devil knows that things have changed since the Garden of Eden. Now, back in the Garden of Eden, of course, it was easy for Adam and Eve to keep the law of God compared to us. Isn't that right? I mean, Adam and Eve had a holy nature, an unfallen, pure nature that was godlike. They were perfect in the beginning. They did not have any carnal nature within them drawing them away to sin. They didn't have the same struggle with temptation that you and I have, because there was nothing within them to respond to the temptations of Satan. They did not have an inherent fallen nature. They had a holy nature just like God, and it was easy for them to obey God compared to what it is for us. But you see, the devil has made us believe, friends, that we can do it just like Adam and Eve, that all we need to do is make up our mind and then put forth the effort and just try hard, and we can do it. And there are a lot of people that have fallen for that, and they feel, well, I don't need God. You know, if I just try hard enough and if I work hard enough, I can make it. Friends, it won't work. It won't work. You can't keep the law of God by yourself and your own strength and by your own effort. It won't work. Now, let me tell you something, and let me ask you something. Suppose that I could keep the law of God absolutely without a flaw from this moment right on down to the rest of my life. If I could keep the commandments of God without making a single mistake or a single error, let me ask you, would that save me? Would that save me if I could obey God perfectly from this moment right on through to the rest of my life? No, it would not. You know why? Because I sinned before this moment. Everybody in the sound of my voice has already sinned, and the sentence of death has come down upon us. And the Bible says, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. I don't care how good you could make yourself be from this point on. Even if you were able to totally keep the commandments of God, you still would have the death sentence upon you. And that would have to be taken care of, you see, by faith in the Lord Jesus and by somebody else outside of your own self. Our record of righteousness, my friends, is imperfect. Everyone who listens to me has had a blurred and blotted record as far as sin is concerned. Our record of right doing has been blurred and blotted. And righteousness, by the way, means right doing. So our righteousness is nothing. Our right doing has not been perfect. The only individual who ever came into this world and had a perfect record of right doing was whom? Jesus Christ, of course. Now, I know people have tried to come up to His, and it's good for us, of course, to be obedient in every way and to make that decision. And I suppose if anybody ever really tried it in their own strength, it was the Pharisees. Oh, how they loved to do the works and the rules. They made up extra ones, hundreds of them, so they'd have more. They thought it would acquire more merit for them. If they could just make up more laws and keep more laws, the more they could do, the more they would earn for their salvation. But one time Jesus said to his own disciples, "Except your righteousness shall exceed that of the Pharisees, you shall in no wise enter the kingdom of God." Can't you see Peter's face fall? He looks at Thomas. Thomas looks at John. John looks at Matthew. And they must wonder, "My, what? How can I have any hope? How will there be any chance for me? If my right doing has to be more than those Pharisees, there's no hope for me." You see, they didn't understand, of course, that Jesus was talking about his righteousness there. But the only one who's done it right, my friends, the only righteousness that God can accept completely and perfectly is the righteousness of his own Son. And unless you and I can get that righteousness to our credit, we're lost. God will never accept anything less than perfect righteousness. And you don't have it and I don't have it, but Jesus does. And somehow I've got to get his righteousness and his perfect record of right doing. I've got to get that on my account. And you know that's exactly what God will do for us. Did you know that? That's exactly what we can have done right now. Let's turn in our Bibles now to Romans 5 and verse 10. And I want you to see something very interesting in this text. Romans 5, verse 10. "For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son." Now pause with me right there. Let's look at something. It says, if when we were enemies, something has happened, friends. Man got separated from God. In the beginning, man was at one with God. There was no enmity at all. They were in perfect unity, in perfect harmony. But something happened to alienate man from God, and they became separated. And now they're enemies, according to this verse. Now, what did God do to bring us back, friends, and cure and heal the enmity that came between us and God? Well, let's read it. If when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son. That's what did it. We became reconciled by his death. Because by accepting the death of Jesus in our place, the atonement and the ransom that he offered by taking our place on the cross, why, my friends, that lifted the death sentence, didn't it? That lifted the death sentence so that we could come back to God and be at one with him again through justification by receiving Christ as our Savior. We can have the death sentence removed. God can look upon us as though we've never sinned, and we can be restored again or reconciled to God. And that's exactly what this tells us, by his death. But now, friends, after we're reconciled to him and after we're justified by faith, what else is there to do? Let's read the rest of the verse. It goes on to say, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. You see, we need both the death of Jesus and the life of Jesus. Did you notice that? We need his death to take care of our justification, to take care of our past sins, so that that can be erased and we can be reconciled to God and be at one with him again. And then it goes on to say that we need his life in order to save us. Well, my friends, that's the imparted strength and power and victory that Jesus had when he lived his life here on this earth. And the Bible said that we can have that life of Jesus, the way he lived it, we can have that imparted to us, just as we can have his atoning death imputed to us. You see, that's justification, and the other is sanctification. We need both justification and sanctification in order to prepare to meet the Lord.
My praise is not enough. is to live for you.
To give.